Now that we have discussed code generation for a language, let's also discuss how code generation is done for object-oriented languages. In particular, we are interested in figuring out how code generation is done for objects in the presence of inheritance. So just to review, what is inheritance? Let's say I declare a type, a class A, and then maybe it has some fields, maybe it has some functions, maybe it also has some virtual functions. And then we declare a derived class B, which derives from A, and it has its own fields and functions, and it can have its own virtual functions, and it can have functions, virtual function implementations of the functions defined in A, which have been overridden by the definition of B. So the first principle or slogan of an object-oriented language is that an object of class B, an object of a derived class, can be used wherever an object of class A is expected. So an object of class B is also an object of class A, and so anything that can be done on object of class A can be done on an object of class B. From a code generation point of view, this means that any code that has been generated for an object of class A should work unmodified for an object of class B. And this is actually a little bit difficult to achieve, as we're going to see in this module and the next few modules. So the implication is that code that's meant for class A should work unmodified for an object of class B. All right. Further, if vfun, or virtual function, is a virtual function in A that is overridden in B, then the call to vfun should choose the callee at runtime. So if vfun is a virtual function that was first defined in A but was overridden in B, then if I call a.vfun, something like this, on an object of class A, then vfun should actually be the function and if small a was an object of class B that is, you know, being used in the context where it is being treated as an object of class A, yet the vfun should be B's implementation, because vfun is a virtual function. This is just by the definition of virtual functions. Virtual functions can be overridden, and their value should be chosen at runtime, depending on what is the actual object. So if B has overridden the definition of vfun, then and small a is an object of type B, then a.vfun should call B's implementation and not A's implementation of vfun. Alright, so here's an example code. Let's say I declare an object of type B, and then I call foo on it, and then I call vfun. So this vfun should actually be B's vfun and not A's vfun. Alright, so there are two questions that primarily arise when we are talking about code generation for object-oriented languages. First of all, code generation for object-oriented languages is not very different from code generation for general languages. So everything that we have discussed so far still holds, with some additional things that you have to do to handle objects, especially with respect to inheritance. So one thing is, how are objects represented in memory? All right, so that, you know, the object should be represented in memory such that the inheritance principle is followed. Okay, and we're going to see how that's done. And second, how is dynamic dispatch implemented? So if I call a.vfun, then automatically the compiler should know whether it should call, at runtime it should resolve the value of vfun, and depending on which object it is, it should either call A's vfun or B's vfun. All right, so let's first talk about the memory layout in the presence of inheritance. So let's say I have a class A and it has a field int x. There could be multiple fields, but I'm just using a single field to demonstrate the point. It has a virtual function va, virtual void va, and it has a non-virtual function fa. There's another class B that derives from class A. It has its own fields y. It overrides va. It has its own static non-virtual function vb, fb. Maybe not, let's not use the word static, but a non-virtual function fb, and then a virtual function vb for class B. Alright, so now the question is, how am I going to represent these objects A and B such that the code meant for A can also work on objects of type B? So the idea is the following, that I'm going to have an object that's going to have, let's say this is an object of type B. And that's why I use small b here to represent an object of type B. and it's pointing to this region of memory, and the region of memory is laid out as follows. Because it derives from class A, it needs to have all the fields of class A. In this case, there's only one field of class A, which is X. So the first we lay out all the fields of class A, X in this case, and then we lay out all the fields of class B, which in this case is Y. All right. The idea here is that A's object representation would look something like this. So if I was to just have an object of class A, then it would look something like this, right? It would also have a V table. So we're going to discuss what a V table is very soon, but let's just bear with me for a minute. And then this would be what an object of class A would look like, all right? It won't have the Y field, but it would have the X field, because it's just an object of class A. It's not an object of class B. And notice that the same code that was going to operate on class on object of class A can now operate on class on object of class B as well, because the first two fields are identical in both. All right, and how is the code that's generated for an object of class A going to work? It's just going to assign an offset for every variable. So, for example, in this case, it can say that X lives at offset 4 from the object. So, in both cases, X is going to live at offset 4 from the object. And now the code can be any code that, you know, sets or gets X can use the offset 4, and that offset 4 will work on both object layouts of B and A. All right. So that's the trick that we're going to play to basically implement inheritance. Okay. I should also point out that this is just one possible strategy to implement inheritance. As from a code generation perspective, there are many more. There can be any number of strategies, and some are more inefficient than others. This is one of the most efficient strategies to generate code to implement inheritance, and this is also one of the most commonly used strategies to generate code for inheritance. All right. Now, what is VTable? VTable is used to implement dynamic dispatch of virtual functions. So what VTable points to is basically a table that contains the names of the pointers to the functions and indexed by their names. So let's say the compiler decides that the first virtual function VA is going to live at offset 0 of the virtual function VTable. And so that's where VA is going to live. And VA is nothing but a pointer. So for example, I could also say this is because it's an object of type B, and because VA has been overridden by class B, so this is probably B's VA, all right? So this is B's VA, right? Maybe I'm just saying B.VA here. Similarly, VB is also B's VB, all right? But if, let's say, there was no, VA override, so if there was no override here, if VA was not overridden by class B, then this would not have been B's VA, but this would have been A's VA, all right? Okay, so that's the idea. Basically, you have one layer of indirection that is resolved by the compiler code, generated code at runtime. So if I want to call VA, I want to dispatch a call to VA, what is the code, generated code, supposed to do? It's supposed to index through the V table at offset 0, pick up the pointer from there, and then call that pointer. All right. So using, let's say, branch and link instruction or something like that. The important point is that the pointer is picked at runtime, and so that's why it's called a dynamic dispatch. It's a runtime dispatch. What function gets called is decided at runtime, and that's achieved by this extra layer of indirection through the V table. All right. Now, there's some more detail here in the V table. So I'm using a real example. This is probably what GCC does for compiling C++ programs. And what it does is it also stores not just the virtual functions in the V table, but also the type ID of the class that maybe this object is appearing in the context of A. But maybe I want to know whether it is actually an object of type A or not at some point. All right. Before I discuss that, I also want to discuss that the layout of these virtual function pointers is also important. For example, I would first lay out all the objects, all the virtual functions of class A. before listing all the virtual functions of class B. And that's also following from the same inheritance principle, because if I look at any object of class A, it would just have VA and it would not have VB, all right? And but the code is just going to say, let's look at offset 0 from V table, and that should work for both objects of class A and of objects of class B. And this trick that we first lay out the objects of the base class and the fields of the base class or the virtual functions of the base class and then lay out the virtual functions of the derived class works. So the same trick that we were using for the fields in the actual object representation, the same trick we can use in the virtual table, function table, V table also. And so the virtual functions are also listed in the same order, first for the base class and then for the derived class. Now, apart from the listing the virtual functions, we also have some extra information that may be required. One of the things is, what is the actual object type ID? And maybe the program may ask for this. And then there is another field which says, what is the offset to the top of the object, right? And in this case, I'm just using zero value here. So it's zero is the actual value and top off is just the description of this value. We can ignore this for the time being, but this basically stands for, from this pointer where V table is pointing, how far up is the top of the object, right? In this case, the top of the object is exactly where the V table is, and so the answer is zero. Right? Why is this required? We don't really require it right now, but we will be requiring it when we talk about multiple inheritance later on. Why do I require the type ID B? Why do I care? Well, the answer is really simple and we know it. The answer is because the programmer may want to know by using the dynamic cast. So if the programmer uses the dynamic cast operator, recall that we discussed the dynamic cast operator when we were talking about type systems, and we said that C++ gives you this operator called dynamic cast. So if the programmer says that I want to cast an object of type A to an object of type B, recall that it can either return null pointer return an actual pointer depending on whether it was actually an object of type B or not. But how will the code figure out whether it is an object of type B or not? Well, the answer is using this type ID. So it's going to dereference to the V table and look at the -4 offset of this this V table and say, what is the type ID? And if that type ID matches with the argument of dynamic cast, which is let's say B, then it's going to return a valid pointer. In this case, it's just going to return the same pointer back, and otherwise it's going to return a null. So the code that's generated to implement dynamic cast involves checking the type ID through an offset of the V table. All right, okay, so let's take another example. Let's say I have three levels of inheritance. So class B inherits from class A. Sorry, this is a typo. So class B inherits from class A and class C inherits from class B. All right, so now we already know what an object of type B looks like. B basically has fields of A, then fields of B. Then it has virtual functions of A and virtual functions of B, and it also has a type ID of the object. In this case, that's B, and then it has a top offset, which in this case is 0. If I was to draw the same figure for an object of type C, what will it look like? Well, it would be very similar. Once again, this is class B inherited from class A. So C is going to have the fields of A followed by fields of B and followed by fields of C. All right, and it's the same order. And once again, the idea is so that the same object can be used in the context of B and in the context of A without any changes. And once again, the virtual functions are also laid out in the same order. Notice that because C does not have a virtual function of its own, we just basically have VA and VB in the virtual function table. All right, in general, more generally, if I have a class hierarchy, let's say AN, AN minus 1 and so on, where A1 is the base class, A2 is the derived class of A1 and so on. This is also the subtyping relation. Then I can basically have a representation, a memory layout of the object such that AN points to a V table followed by the fields of AN, such that the first few fields are the A1's fields. Then they are followed by A2's fields, then A3's fields, and so on. And so the first few bytes, the first few region here represents an A1 object. Then you know, including that region and some more is A2, then including that region and some more is A3, and so on until the whole object is covered, which is the entire object. And this strategy, this code generation strategy, will ensure that the same memory layout of the object can be used in either context of A1, A2, A3, and so on. All right. Similarly, if I look at the layout of the V table, it's similar. So the V table, so there's only a single V table for the entire, for the entire hierarchy, for all the classes in the entire hierarchy, and that V table will have the following format. It would have the virtual functions of A1 followed by the virtual functions of A2, and so on, right, till the virtual functions of A n. Notice that it's possible that A2 overrides some virtual functions of A1, in which case it would just mean that the pointer here has been changed, all right, and that's fine. But the layout doesn't change, and so the code can still, the same code should still work for both A1 and A2 and AN and so on, the code that was meant for A1. Also, there is the notion of a type ID, that is the field that's just above the vtable pointer, let's say -4 of vtable pointer, and that basically says whether it's actually A1, A2, A3, AN, and that's useful for the dynamic cast operator. And finally, there is this field called top offset, which says if this is my original pointer AN, then what is the top of the object? The top of the object actually in this case happens to be the same pointer, and so the answer so far, this is always going to be 0, but we're going to see some examples where this can be non-zero as well.